I missed you last week. My wife and I were on the leadership retreat, and people asked if we had a good time. We did, but I'm not much of a cruiser. I'll go in 3 years when the district goes again, but I like sand and camping, and cruising just wasn't my speed, I think. But I had a great time with the relationships on the district, and as far as retreats go, it was the best retreat that I've ever been on for developing relationships with other pastors on the district. And for that, we are very thankful that we had the opportunity to get away. Pastor Milton, as always, does a great job preaching when I'm gone, and I so appreciate the great word he shared with us. And I asked his wife, I said, did you enjoy hearing your husband preach yesterday or last week? And she beamed and glowed as she would. Well, the last 5 weeks since the 1st of January, we've been telling you that this was going to be the Sunday we talked about money, and you came. So thank you for coming, and want to congratulate you for having the courage to be here today, and it'll be a great morning. Before we get there, I wanted to let you know that here in just a few moments, we're going to be looking at a passage in 2 Corinthians. Later on in the message, we may even call your attention to a passage in Luke chapter 6 if you wanted to work ahead, but the main passage this morning is 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 to 8. But before we read that, I wanted to review for a moment this morning with you kind of where we've been, and since this is the last Sunday, I wanted to remind you one more time about this acrostic blend and what it stands for. The B, as you remember, stands for bringing hearts together to celebrate, encounter, and adore our God. That is bringing worship. The first part of stewardship is bringing our worship to the Lord. The L, if you remember, stands for lending partnerships, or lending our lives to the faith community. The E stood for engaging discipleship, or engaging in practices for spiritual growth. And as you remember, 2 weeks ago, we were going to gather and consider what it meant to never give less. That's the N. But the notorious ice of the upstate got in the way of that. But we're coming back to it today. Then Pastor Milton did a great job last week calling our attention to the D in the word blend, devoted friendship, devoting ourselves to sharing God's good news to others. And so today we consider the N, that is never giving less than our best to God's kingdom. My prayer is that when you leave today, you would develop a new appreciation for what it means to be a steward of all that God has entrusted to you, and that you would live life with the realization that I'm never going to give less than my best to God and to his kingdom. With that in mind, we turn our attention to the passage in 2 Corinthians, beginning at verse 6. Paul writes to the Corinthians, the point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. For those of you who are faithful in your giving, I want to begin this morning by saying thank you. And to those of you that are watching online today on our live stream and watch on YouTube later who also may not attend our church but are faithful givers, I want to thank you as well. I want to thank you for your sacrifice and your stewardship to the Lord and for your obedience in joining him in giving. But whether you're a part of the group that is a regular giver or not, we all can grow in our understanding of what it means to be a steward of what God has entrusted to us. The financial state of our world, especially the United States, is not that good. And since 2008, our federal government has printed and just kind of tossed into the economy about $4 trillion to make sure that they can say that the economy is strong. Now, this is not a Democrat or Republican thing. This is a both thing. The reality is that since 2006, our federal debt has doubled. people talk about reducing the deficit. I certainly hope you understand what it is that they talk about when they say that. All we raise this much money. Past that point is deficit spending. All our politicians are talking about is overspending less than the last guy. Do you realize that when they talk about deficit spending, that's what they're saying? Nobody is talking about not spending more than we make. They're all talking about reducing. They all talk about let's spend more than we make. That is the culture in which we live. It is a disastrous way to live, that we would just live recklessly with the assumption that it's all going to be okay in the end, that somehow it will all work out. The struggle is very real from a political standpoint, because what are you going to cut? I don't know how informed you are about the state of things in the United States, but if you eliminate the military altogether, our budget still isn't balanced. Now, with that reality, we are in a tough place in America when it comes to spending. This spills over into personal spending and the way in which we manage our that which God has entrusted to us. So that's the environment in which we speak today. The reality is that that God calls us to financial obedience. And I'm excited about today. I really am. Because the enemy has come to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus has come to give you life. He has. He's come to give you life. He's come to set you free financially as well. And I'm excited by this message. I'm not apologetic about this message at all. I know that the church has received a bad reputation for talking about money. If you are concerned about that, I'll probably talk about money a year from now. And so you'll be okay between now and another 365 days. But I'm excited to talk about money because the Bible talks about money. And God has a desire for you, and that excites me. And the call is to financial obedience. Now, just in case you do not know, we live in a time of an increasing secularization of society. That means that it is entirely possible that there are some individuals in our sanctuary this morning that do not know what financial obedience means. That is okay. You're not alone. The Old Testament paradigm is that God calls us to give 10% of what we make to the church in which we attend. In other words, we give it to Him. We don't get to decide what happens with that 10%. We give it to Him. We don't designate it. We don't control it. He gets it, and we have a hands-off approach to those funds. 10%. Now, it does not matter whether your 10% is a dime, 10,000, or 100,000. See, the enemy, because he wants to steal from you, would cause those that make a little to say, you know what, in the grand scheme of things, my giving ultimately does not matter. I only make a dollar, and so the church doesn't need my dime, my literal dime. There are some that would say, well, I make a million. The church doesn't need my 100,000. You're missing the point. The point is that God calls us, regardless of whatever it is that we make, to walk in obedience with Him. And the starting place for that is 10%. Now you say the starting place. We'll talk about what that means here in a moment. But the starting place is 10%. From my very first days, my first job was a Burger King employee. I was about 16 years old, and I went to Burger King, and I worked and I worked. I went to college and I worked my way through Burger King, working in the summer at Burger King, working during the school year, washing dishes in the cafeteria. It was a messy, messy job. I got up at 5:30 in the morning to go wash dishes to help pay my tuition. And every single check from the first job in my childhood, I gave 10% of it to the Lord. My wife and I were talking. My first job as an associate pastor was part-time. We made $10,000 a year, had two children, and didn't know we could qualify for any government assistance. We lived on chicken thighs and tube burger from Aldi's. To this day, I see chicken thighs, and it makes me twitch. It just makes you sick to think of a chicken thigh. That's why I eat chicken wings instead, having some of those tonight. We had a car problem, needed $100, and we didn't have $100. Somebody came, knocked on the door. We opened the door. There a man stood with a $100 bill saying, "God has called me to come hand you this, and I don't know why." We never, ever considered taking God's money and spending it on the car bill. I know a man who shared a testimony with me that he had given his tithe, and he was tempted to take the tithe and use it to pay his mortgage. And he was like, "God, I'm giving this to you. I don't know what I'm going to do to pay my mortgage." He went to the mailbox that day, and the exact amount that he was short, somebody felt compelled to send him cash in the mail. And the day his mortgage was due, the cash showed up, and he went to the bank and paid his mortgage. I could spend the entire service this morning sharing with you how it is that God provides to individuals that walk in obedience to Him when it comes to finances. I don't know how it works. I can't explain it. It is a uniquely spiritual thing, brothers and sisters. But when we say yes to God financially and we give to Him as He calls us to give, He always, always provides for us. It is His promise. He says to us, if we give generously, He lavishes generously. And financial obedience is so critical to us. The enemy wants to steal from you. Now, the cool part is that when we give not only to a church, we're giving to a mission. Our mission is God, family, neighbor. We are GFN Church. And there's a big difference between the over 50 crowd and the under 25 crowd when it comes to giving. And we need to recognize that as a church. The things that motivated me even in my time is very different than the things that are going to motivate the 20-year-old. Very, very different. Somebody who is in the second half of their life is going to largely be shaped by the fact God says to do it, so I'm going to do it. Now, I think our young need to come to the place where if God calls us to do something, we obey. But until they get there, can we at least give our young people a motivation for giving? And we're trying to do that here in our context so that we can help them to come to a place where God is able to demonstrate in their heart and life that God really does keep His word. When God makes a promise, He'll keep His word. When God makes a financial promise, He keeps His word. So we are a church that believes in God, family, neighbor. When you give, you're giving to making Christ-like disciples. I could tell you story after story as to how God is making Christ-like disciples in our church. When we give, we're giving to invest in family and how it is that we connect in relationship with each other. When we give, we're giving to investing in neighbor. Now, here this winter, we're preparing to launch some new initiatives, both as it relates to family and neighbor, and I'm very excited by it. And we're going to be sharing those initiatives with you soon, but when you give, you're giving to God, family, neighbor. You're not giving to an entity. You're not giving to an organization. In one sense of the word, you're giving to a mission, a cause that Jesus calls us to share together. God calls us to financial obedience. The second thing that we see in our passage this morning is that money is a spiritual magnifying glass. Money will reveal to you whether you're a person that lives by faith. Money will reveal to you whether you're a person that trusts God enough to obey God. Money will reveal to you whether you're a person who is engaged in ongoing commitment to God and to his mission. Money will reveal to God whether or not you are self-centered or other-centered. Money will reveal to God whether or not you can be trusted to manage that which is his alone to control. I'm going to say that phrase again because it is critical that you get that phrase. Money demonstrates to God whether we can be trusted to manage what is his alone to control. Money is a magnifying glass to our heart. It speaks to us about what it is that we value in life. It speaks to us about the things that we hold dear. It speaks enormously to God about what it is that we really believe about his word. Do we believe that when God says he's going to do something, that he's going to do it? Do we believe that when God says he's going to provide, that he will? Money is a magnifying glass, a spiritual magnifying glass into our heart, and it reveals a great deal about who we are in relationship with him. It's a magnifying glass. Unfortunately, we live in a world that's driven by political philosophies about money. On the one side is a political philosophy that says none of you can be trusted to keep anything that you have, so we should give more and more of it to the government because they can manage it well, and we already have seen how well they do at that. The other side says that it's all yours and the government should keep its grubby hands off of your money. Thanks for nobody saying amen to that. I appreciate that. Because both of those philosophies are unbiblical. And if you are shaped by, if your financial understanding is shaped by the political philosophies of our world, God help us. It's money. When we enter into relationship with God and we declare him as our Lord and Savior, the money is no longer ours. I'll render to Caesar what is Caesar. If you don't know what that means, it's a biblical call that we give to the government what the government demands, and the rest we give to God. Now we ask him, okay, God, now that all of this is yours, what do you want me to do with it? Brother and sister, do not be shaped by the political philosophies of our world when it comes to finances. I implore you, do not get sucked into the political philosophies that are being thrown at us by a culture that wants to shape our understanding of finances. Most of what we hear on every news network is not shaped by biblical philosophies when it comes to money. Please, I implore you, do not be one that just embraces these political philosophies when it comes to finances. Don't do it. Because money is a spiritual magnifying glass to the soul, embracing those philosophies speaks a great deal about who we are in relationship with the Lord. So often I want to post on social media, are people out of their mind? These smart people that love the Lord who are just embracing things that Jesus would scratch his head over. My wife and I don't know what in the world we're going to do this year. We don't have much time to make up our mind before whoever probably gets the most votes in South Carolina is getting ready to be elected, from what I'm told. I don't know what I'm going to do. Other than do my best as a pastor to encourage the people entrusted to me, to live a life that follows biblical principles when it comes to finance. I believe that is the hope we have, that Jesus Christ, transforming our understanding of the world, he can change our world through folks like you and me. So you say you're a tither, you give, and praise the Lord. I'm glad that you do. I'm so thankful that you do. There is something that we still need to consider, and that's the third thought for this morning, and that's the idea that we should live generously. I was in a worship service. I won't share the context of the worship service, but it was not a primarily white English service. I'm sitting in the back. I'm there to support the pastor that had been going through some difficulties, and the other pastors in the community were gathering around the pastor and the congregation to show their support. And I'm sitting in the back. I'm a minority in the room. And came time to receive the offering, and I pulled out my wallet. I have my gift there. And the person that was leading the offering said, "Everybody, put your gift in the air." So everybody put their gift in the air. Aren't you glad we don't do this? Put your gift in the air. And so I'm like, okay. And he goes, "Now, brothers and sisters, I want you to know, Luke chapter 6 says that the measure in which you give will be the measure in which the Lord pours himself out to you. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. Look at that gift. Is that how you want the Lord to bless you?" And I'm thinking, oh, man, I didn't bring any more money. So it was, and then I'm like, okay, are you ready to come forward? And I'm like, oh no, I got to go forward. I'm like, I don't want to go forward. And I'm like on the aisle, and there are all these people that got to get to the aisle, and they're all looking at me. They're like, "Go on, brother, go on." Oh man, I was like scared. So I went forward and put my gift. I wrapped my arms around the pastor we were there to support and walked back around. I'm sweating. Then I was in our Spanish congregation just a couple weeks ago. And they whipped out their tithe envelopes, man. They were waving there. They were doing the same thing. So I don't think I can get away with that in the first service. I give online, and the ushers come by me every Sunday, and they don't even tap me on the shoulder anymore. I just don't put anything in there. I always give online. Somebody else was telling me, every time the ushers go by, they don't bother me anymore. They just keep on going. But I hope they know that I'm giving online. I'm sure they do. If I give my 10%, that is my starting place. And because I give to Caesar what is Caesar's, I give to the government what the government demands, and the rest is God's, the question is, why doesn't the New Testament talk about 10% when the Old Testament does? And here's the reason. In the Old Testament, there was the call to give 10%. So what did they do? They gave their 10%, they checked the spiritual box, and they went on their merry way using the remainder of the funds without any care about what God had to say about it. Into that environment, Jesus speaks, and he says, "I don't want you to give the 10%. I want you to give all of it." Now, some of you are like, "Oh, no. Jesus wants me to do what? How am I going to pay my mortgage if Jesus asks me to give it all?" Well, Jesus asks you to give it all. I'm not asking you to give it all, okay? So I want you to take a sigh, a deep breath. I'm not asking you to give it all. Now, here's what I do know. I know that some people have come to conclude that God has blessed them in a way where they're going to live on the 10% and give the 90%. That's what God has called them to do. If God has called us to give it all to him, then the question about tithing is our starting point, and then everything else is an opportunity to ask God, how is it that he wants me to use the other 90% after the government gets involved? How, God, do you want me to use this 90%? This is the world of generosity. And the Bible is very clear about this, folks. It is a spiritual principle that the measure in which I give is the measure in which God blesses. Now, televangelists have destroyed this spiritual truth. You will never hear me say, you give me or the church $1,000 today, God's going to give you $10,000 tomorrow. You will never hear me say that. If you hear a televangelist say that on television, please, will you turn the channel? That is not what the Bible says. It primarily speaks in terms of grace and giving. The measure in which we give is the measure in which God gives. The measure in which we forgive, God forgives. The measure in which we are people of grace, God is a person of grace. The measure to which we give is the measure in which God gives. These are spiritual realities that are promises that God has made to us. And there are not many in our world that test this. How do I know? 17% of people who attend church regularly, when asked, "Do you tithe?" would say yes. You know what percentage of people that don't attend church give regularly? 75%. You want to know why our young people are disillusioned with the church? There's one reason. Their friends that don't go to church tend to be more generous than those that do. And it's destroying our young. We need to model, brothers and sisters, this idea of generosity so that our young people can look at us who are testifying to the power and grace of God that calls us to give, who proves himself faithful, and our young people will see that generosity and catch the generosity bug. God is raising that bug up in them without our influence. So can I tell our young people, thank you for that? Thank you for desiring generosity. And your pastor's committed to helping lead our church. I want you to know we are not waiting around for an increase of funds to be a generous church with our community. I don't have the funds to do what I have a dream to do right now, but we're going to start anyway. What a dream that I have is that whatever classroom that we adopt to help read, would it not be cool to give every third grader a $1,000 promise? That if you learn how to read and graduate from high school and go to college, GFN Church will give you a $1,000 scholarship. Why can't we do that? $30,000 a year to change a kid's life. I don't have that kind of money yet. But why not? Why not GFN Church live generously to change a kid's life? The enemy is here to steal from you, to rob from you, to destroy your joy. And Jesus says, rethink this whole financial paradigm and watch how I transform your life. Now, here's a promise that I'm going to make for you. I did not get board approval for it, and we have a board meeting on Tuesday, so I'm all ready for any ramifications that may come from this promise that I'm getting ready to make. And the board, Ron and Rob, are already looking at each other saying, what is he getting ready to say? Here's my promise to you. If you take a step of faith and tithe, and you come to a place where you cannot make ends meet, God does not prove himself true to you, and you need help paying your bills, you come to my office. I will have Ron write a refund check for your giving, and I will help coach you, or somebody that I trust will help coach you on how it is to manage the funds that God has entrusted to you so that you can come to a place where you can obey God in your giving. Will you test God in this and see if he does not pour out the floodgates of blessing in your life? This is my promise to you. And I can make it because it's not my promise. It's God's promise. It's his promise to you. You say, we haven't received the offering yet. Well, that's because we're doing it at the end today. You say, well, Pastor, I want to test the Lord on this, but I didn't bring my checkbook. That's all right. You can give online. I already asked our tech guys, will our wireless and giving system tolerate 20 or 30 people all giving online at the exact same time? I don't know the answer to that question. We think that it will. That's what I do. I give online. And all I ask is that you do this. Test the Lord and see if he will keep his promise. Will you join me in prayer? Father, as Pastor Tim said earlier, it is not our desire to pressure our guests. We want them to enjoy this morning of worship. But Lord, the enemy has been stealing from some of us. The enemy has been robbing from us. We have lived in fear from the phone ringing, wondering who is calling. We've been afraid to go to the mailbox for the bills that might be there. We've been living in fear. It is time, Father, to face the challenges that are before us financially. It's time for us to believe that when your word says that we embrace biblical patterns for managing money, that you pour blessing out on your people. It's time for us to believe that your word is true, that you are good for your promises, that you keep your word, that you will not let your kids fall and stumble. Your word says, take a measuring cup. You can put a little bit of flour in there, and a little flour will come out. But Jesus, you also said, you can tamp it down. Get as much flour in there as you can, and I'll pour that much out. Father, help us to test you. Your word makes it really easy for a pastor to make a promise to his people. Father, if anyone in this room decides to test you by faith, I will give as you call me to give. Father, if they ever need it to pay their bills, we're going to give it back to them. But we're also going to help them. How is it that we can help each other? To demonstrate to you that we can be trusted to manage that which is yours alone to control. Thank you, Father, for being a promise-keeping Father. And for giving us your spirit that gives us the courage to say yes to you. We give to you today with a rejoicing heart and a gracious spirit. Help us to live generously in Jesus' name.